welcome Bill to the stage to perform Dublin 1916. And Martha Colburn, his expert.
I have to just say before I get started, I'm intimidated by the beauty of all this poetry.
Oh.
I feel honored to be here. Thank you. Well, good evening to all of you. My name is Narrator X. I don't have a name because I'm going to be talking about the matters of the soul. And the soul has no name. So thank you for coming out this evening to listen to this old man talk about events that happened 100 years ago in a place called Dublin, Ireland. I'm going to read to you an account, a report, really, of the rising of 1916. In April of 1916 in Dublin. And then after I've read to you the story, I'm going to do a little analysis, you know. Wouldn't be anything if I didn't do an analysis, which is, it's not going to be a historical analysis. It won't be a military analysis. It won't even be a literary analysis. It really is just a human analysis. Because that's what this is all about. So I want to tell you a story, a tragic story of a man and men and women who refused to be defeated, even when the powers that be grasped them in their claws. These men and women refused to lose hope. To the outside eye, it appeared they had lost. They had not achieved their objective, liberation from the oppressors. But they knew they had kindled a fire that could not be put out. I speak, of course, of the rising in Dublin of 1916, in Easter of that year. And more, I speak of a leader who never doubted his cause, even when he knew he would never achieve the freedom he wanted for himself. He kept hope. I'm speaking, of course, of Patrick Pearse. And he kept up his hope even as he was going to the firing squad. And he went to that firing squad whistling. This is the story of Patrick Pearse, then, the leader of the Irish Volunteers. Organized, I realize that just I'm reading without my glasses, you know? There's something wrong with that. Organized by a seven-man military council of the Irish Republican Brotherhood, the rising began on Easter Monday, 24 April 1916, and lasted for 6 days. 6 whole days. Why, it's like Shakespeare, isn't it? Well, the members of the Irish Volunteers, led by schoolmaster and language activist Patrick Pearse, joined a smaller group of people from the Irish Citizen Army, led by James Connolly, and 200 women of Cumnaban, who seized locations in Dublin and proclaimed the Irish Republic. During this little reading that I'm doing for you here, I'm going to ask you to imagine with me, if you will, certain kinds of events. The first one I want you to imagine is Patrick Pearse, who was a teacher, in his room with his pupils, talking to them about Ireland. He reads them first a line from his play called The Master. He writes, May one not serve the people by bearing testimony in their midst to a true thing. And then he goes on, standing before his pupils now, and reads a short poem called I Am Ireland. I am Ireland, I am older than the woman of Bear. Great my glory, mine own children have sold their mother. Great my glory, I bore Cuchulain the valiant. I am Ireland, I am lonelier than the old woman of Bear. The old woman of Bear is a goddess in Ireland from the west. She is the land. The Irish Citizen Army and James Connolly and these 200 women seized key locations in Dublin and way to the center of the city. I want to ask now some of the more prominent women who came to assist and revolt with the rest of this Irishmen. So I'm going to ask first Winifred Kearney to come up and talk to you about what she did.
Hi, my name is Winifred Kearney and I was there. I arrived at the General Post Office Easter Monday 24, April 1916. I was armed with a revolver and my typewriter. I held the rank of adjutant. I stayed there until the surrender. When Patty Pierce ordered me to leave on the last day, I refused to leave the side of James Connolly, who was wounded. After the surrender, I was sent to Kilmainham Gaol with the rest of the rebels. We wanted to be treated as ordinary prisoners like Countess Markievicz, but the Brits refused. I was released 2 days before Christmas 1916.
Thank you, Winifred. Now I'm going to ask Countess Markievicz to tell you about her experiences during the revolution.
I fought at St. Stephen's Green and killed a policeman there. Like the others, I was sent to Kilmainham Gaol. 3 weeks after my arrest, I was tried. At my trial, I said, I went out to fight for Ireland's freedom, and it does not matter what happens to me. I did what I thought was right, and I stand by it. They sentenced me to death, but later commuted the sentence to life imprisonment. When I got that news, I said, I do wish your lot had the decency to shoot me. I was released from prison in 1917.
Thank you, Countess, and I want one more witness, if I might, Elizabeth O'Farrell.
I was a nurse and stayed in the General Post Office to the last. I refused to leave. Well, I did, but only to deliver the surrender documents to the Brits. I later wrote this in my journal. So I started through the firing line from Butt Bridge to Boland's Mill. This was a very difficult job, and I had to take my life in my hands several times. When I came to Westland Row, the military was lined across the top. They were screaming at me to go back, but I kept on waving my white flag and paper. Crossing Grand Canal Street Bridge, the firing was terrific. At this point, a man crossing the bridge about half a yard behind me was shot.
Thank you, Elizabeth, and thank you for all the women who served in that rebellion. I'd like to... Oh, there we go. Got the wrong page. Sorry.
I'm sorry.
The British Army brought in thousands of reinforcements and artillery in a gunboat up the Liffey. The Liffey River runs right through Dublin. It's the center, and they bring a gunboat up. Well, you think the Bank of Ireland was being robbed. There was fierce fighting in the city routes to the center, and the rebels put up a stiff resistance, slowing the British advance and inflicting heavy casualties. Elsewhere in Dublin, fighting was mainly of sniping and long-range gunfire. The main rebels' positions were gradually surrounded and bombarded with artillery. Artillery! No less. These British were really frightened of these few men and women. There were isolated actions in other parts of Ireland, with attacks at the Royal Irish Constabulary Barracks at Ashbourne, County Meath, County Cork, County Galway, and the seizure of the town of Enniscorthy, County Wexford. The Germans had sent a shipment of arms to the rebels, but the English had intercepted it and seized it before the rebels could get them for the rising. Now I'm going to ask you again to imagine something with me, if you will. Imagine Patrick Pierce as he steps out from the GPU, and he's going to read the Provisional Government of the Irish Republic. This is a declaration of freedom. In the name of God and the dead generations from which she receives her old tradition of nationhood, Ireland, through us, summons her children to the flag and strikes for freedom. Having organized and trained her manhood through her secret revolutionary organization, the Irish Republican Brotherhood, and through her open military organization, the Irish Volunteers, and the Irish Citizen Army, having patiently perfected her discipline, having resolutely waited for the right moment to reveal herself, she now seizes that moment, and supported by her exiled children in America and gallant allies in Europe, but relying first and foremost on her own strength, she strikes in full confidence of victory. We declare the right of the people of Ireland to the ownership of Ireland and to the unfettered control of Irish destinies to be sovereign and indefeasible. The long usurpation of that right by a foreign people and government has not extinguished that right, nor can it ever be extinguished except by the destruction of the Irish people. In every generation, the Irish people have asserted their right to national freedom and sovereignty. 6 times during the last 300 years, they have asserted their right to national freedom and sovereignty in arms. In every generation, then, they have sought national freedom and sovereignty, standing on that fundamental right and again asserting in arms in the face of the world. We hereby proclaim the Irish Republic is a sovereign independent state, and we pledge our lives and the lives of our comrades in arms to the cause of freedom and its welfare and the exaltation of the Irish nation. The Irish Republic is entitled to and hereby claims the allegiance of every Irishman and Irishwoman. The Republic guarantees the religious and civil liberty, equal rights, and equal opportunities of all of its citizens.